you can do more with Spring Boot than just build cloud-native microservices. But building microservices is one of Spring Boot's big selling features. And of course, if you're building microservices, you're probably going to want to put them in a container. And if you're going to containerize your Spring Boot applications, you're probably going to be using Docker, which is what I want to walk you through here. I want to show you how to create an application in Spring Boot that will support Dockerization. I want to show you how to create a Docker build file, create a Docker image out of your Spring Boot application, run your Spring Boot application as a Docker image, and then even push your image up to Docker Hub, after which I'll quickly show you how to deploy that Spring Boot application to AWS Fargate and actually put your microservice up in the cloud. Hi, I'm Cameron McKenzie. I'm the editor-in-chief over at theserverside.com, and I have to be one of the world's biggest Spring Boot advocates. And I wanted to just quickly show you how to Dockerize a Spring Boot application, starting off with showing you how you should create your Spring Boot applications to begin with so that they'll easily support that Dockerization. Let's face it, Dockerizing a Spring Boot application is a fairly advanced topic, so I'm not going to waste your time by going over how to create a Spring Boot application. In fact, in this example, I'm going to use the Spring Boot application that I created in a previous tutorial where you can play a little rock, paper, scissors game. So the Spring Boot application has a web UI, but at the same time, it also has a RESTful API as well, where you can ask for the score and it tells you the wins, losses, and ties in the game. Now, I do want to talk to you about something before I Dockerize this application, though. I do want to talk to you about what you should do when you build a Spring Boot application that you want to Dockerize easily. One of the things that you want to do is make sure that you specify the packaging type as a jar. That's what I've done, and that's going to make your Dockerization a lot easier. If you specify the packaging type as jar, Spring Boot will package a Tomcat server inside that jar file to run your application. So there's an embedded Tomcat server inside that jar. If you select war, that Tomcat server isn't embedded, and as a result, you've got to find a Docker image that has Wildflyer, Tomcat, or Jetty already installed on it. Because I've done this, I've packaged this as a jar file, I don't have to worry about that. Tomcat server is already inside the jar. Now, by the way, I do have my little Maven POM file here. You can see that the artifact ID is Rashambo and the version is 001. That will actually come out in the naming of the jar file that gets created. So that's just something to keep in mind. I'm in my application that I want to actually Dockerize. And so the first thing you want to do is actually do a Maven build or a Gradle build or a Maven install. And this is actually just going to build the application and actually make sure that the jar file is in the Walmart folder for deployment, sorry, the target folder for deployment. And as that runs, I'm actually going to open up that target folder. It's going to say show in System Explorer. There's the target folder right there. And there I can see my Rashambo jar file created. Okay, that is the jar file that I want to put into a Docker image, and specifically a Java Docker image. And my plan is to deploy this to Amazon. So I'm going to use an Amazon Java image. And so what I need to do next is I actually need to create the Docker file that'll be used to build this application. So I create a new file. I'm going to create this in the root of my project, just called Dockerfile, no extension whatsoever. And to save a little bit of time, I don't think you want to see me type all of this out. I'm going to paste in the contents of the Dockerfile. As you can see, I'm starting from Amazon Coretto version 17. If you're building on Java 21, which I really should be because that is the latest LTS release of Java, you can change that to 21. I put the maintainer label in there, and I've also copied that Rashambo jar file from the target folder, right? Rashambo 001 snapshot.jar. I'm taking that jar file and I'm copying it into the Docker image with the name app.jar. App.jar just tends to be convention. Then you can see the entry point says when anybody runs this Docker image, what we'll do is we'll run that Java jar file. That's the entry point entry in that file. So that is your Spring Boot Docker file. Now, the next thing we need to do is actually build this file. I actually have a Docker repository, a Docker Hub account, and the account is CameronMCNZ. I want to take my Docker image that I create locally and push it up to Docker Hub for everybody to enjoy. In order to do that, you need to tag the image that you create with your name. And so the command that I'm going to issue to build and create this Docker image is going to include that name. Now I'm going to say show in terminal because I need to run a couple of commands. So I'm going to right click and say show in terminal. This will open up a terminal window inside Eclipse that is right in the root of my project. And from here, I can just say, hey, Docker, I want to build a new image. I want you to tag it to be my Docker Hub name, CameronMCNZ/Rochambeau:latest. And then a dot, and that dot is required. It says look for a file named Dockerfile in the current folder, right? Like whenever you're creating a web page and dot slash, that always means current folder, right? So don't forget that dot there. And when I click enter, boom, it goes ahead and it starts building this Spring Boot Docker image for me. Now, looks like it's done. I'm going to do click Control L to clear the screen. Looks like I can't clear the screen inside this terminal. So instead, what I will do is I'll just say Docker images. And you'll have to look down to the bottom of the screen there to see that we do have CameronMCNZ Rochambeau running. Now, this runs on port 8080. Now, I've already got something running on port 8080. That's the actual Spring Boot application inside of Eclipse. I'm going to run this. So I'm going to say Docker run, but I'm going to do a port mapping for 80 Wayne Gretzky, 8099. So I'm going to say expose port 8099 on the host machine and map that to 8080 on the application running internally in the Docker container. And of course, what am I running? It's Cameron MCNZ slash Rochambeau. By the way, CameronMCNZ is my Twitter handle, so feel free to go follow me over there. Say hello. So we're going to run this on port 80 Wayne Gretzky. It's going to think about it. It looks like it's going to run. And as that runs, I'm going to head over to my browser and change this to 80 Wayne Gretzky. And boom, we get the wins, losses, and ties. And I'm going to say index.html. And there we go. Our application is indeed running. So we've Dockerized this application. Now, what's next? Now, I did say that I wanted to push this all the way up to Docker Hub. So I'm going to open up a terminal window here and say Docker images. Looks like we've got CameronMCNZ Rochambeau in there. Let's get it all on one line. I'm going to do a little Docker login. Looks like I'm already logged in. Otherwise, you've got to provide your credentials there. And I'm just going to say Docker push. And it says Docker push requires one argument. So I'm going to say Docker push CameronMCNZ slash Rochambeau. I guess you got to tell it the image you want to push. I've been working with Git for far too long. So there we go. Docker push CameronMCNZ slash Rochambeau. That's the name of the image that I created locally. It says that it's pushed, but I'm from Missouri. So I'm going to come over to my Docker repository. It's not there. What didn't work? I'm just joking. Got to do a refresh. And I do the refresh and boom, there is CameronMCNZ slash Rochambeau. That is my application containerized. The Spring Boot app is Dockerized and it's even pushed up to Docker Hub, a Docker repository so that anybody can run this. You can go out to your own machine. You can say Docker run dash P 8080:8080/CameronMCNZ/Rochambeau:latest. That application will run on your local machine. Now, what's next? I'd really like to show you how to push this up to AWS. So if you stick around, pushing this application up to AWS is what we're going to do next. So let's see just how easy it is to deploy this Dockerized Spring Boot application to AWS. I'm going to copy the name of my image over on Docker Hub because we're going to need that in just a moment. And then I'm going to mosey on over to AWS and I'm going to look for the Elastic Container Service. And there it is right there because that's where we're going to deploy this image. First thing we need to do is create a task that describes our container, describes the container that we want to deploy and the port mappings and things along those lines. So I'm going to come over here. I'm going to create a new task definition. I'm going to keep this simple. I'm not going to parameterize this heavily. And I'm going to take a lot of defaults and I might even do a few things that might make this less secure than you'd really want it to be. But I'll call it my Rochambeau container task because that's sort of what it is. We're going to use AWS Fargate, which is a simple way just to deploy a container into AWS. I think one CPU and 3 gigs of memory should be enough for a rock, paper, scissors game. And I'm going to leave the defaults on the execution rules. Actually, no, I'll make that ECS task execution rule. That should work well for both of these. If that doesn't show up, you can just use the option to create a new one, which will be there if a task doesn't already exist. Now, this is what's really important here. It's the container, CameronMCNZ/Rochambeau. You can put :latest there if you want, but if you don't, it'll just pull the latest one anyways, and I'll call it my Rochambeau container. Okay, that sets the container in there. And now also, we need a port mapping. And so I want to map an expose port 8080. So I'm going to leave that there as the exposed port mapping. I mean, if you've got port 80 as a mapping as well, you can add that in, but I don't, so I can remove that, but it doesn't do any harm by leaving it there. And I'm going to accept the rest of these defaults here and just create this basic task. It's a basic application, so we don't have to do anything crazy here. But essentially, I've described the container and I've described the ports to open to support the application. And I've described how many resources, memory and CPU cycles should be allocated to supporting this container when we run it. So with that done, we now need to create a cluster, create an environment where we can run these tasks. So I'm going to create a brand new cluster. I'm going to call it my cool Rochambeau cluster. So we create the cluster. Not too much to configure there. It's AWS Fargate serverless cluster. So looks like that cluster has been created. And now once the cluster is created, what we do is we run the task on the cluster. So the cluster is now created. I'm going to click on that cluster. I'm going to come over here and look at tasks because it's a task that I want to run. And I'm going to select run new task. A couple of things I'll have to select here. I'm going to scroll down a little bit. It's going to ask me which task to run. And obviously, it's my Rochambeau container task that I want to run. There's no revision, so it's the first one that I want right there. Let's take a look at the networking. Well, I do want my basic VPC to run this, and I'm going to want this to run in a public subnet at the very least. So that looks good. I'm going to use a new security group. And in this security group, what I'm going to do is I'm going to allow all TCP, heck, I'm going to allow all traffic. I'm going to live dangerously here from anywhere. This just gets it working. I don't recommend you do this in production, but we've now got a security group that's going to let any traffic through to our container. Again, I want to make sure that everything looks good there. We do have public subnets working. Okay, now I'm going to click create, and this is going to create that task. It's It's going to run the container, and it's going to give me an IP address. I'm going to click on this container here. Look at that public IP address that it's going to assign. And in a minute, when this starts running, I'm going to go to this IP address and see if my rock, paper, scissors application is running on port 8080, which is the port that I use for the application when I configure the container as a task. Okay, I'm becoming impatient, so I'm going to click open address. I'll go to port 8080, and boom, my rock, paper, scissors application is hosted and it is running. And furthermore, when I go to slash score, I get the wins, losses, and ties, which actually is getting pulled from the embedded H2 database. So it's doing some Spring data and Spring JDBC there as well. So there you go. That's how easy it is to deploy your applications up there into AWS, into Fargate. You can even take a look at the log files that were created there. There's that little ASCII art that says Spring Boot that happens when you start a Spring Boot application. So there you go. That's how easy it is to Dockerize a Spring Boot application and push that Spring Boot application up to AWS and host it on AWS Fargate. There's probably some configurations with load balancers that you might want to do. So this is just the basics, but it gets you started. Now, if you enjoyed that tutorial, why don't you head over to theserverside.com. I'm the editor-in-chief over there. We got lots of great tutorials on Spring, on Docker, on AWS, on Java. If you're interested in my personal antics, you can always follow me on Twitter at CameronMCNZ. Go say hi over there. And of course, I got a couple of books back here too. So I wrote Hibernate Made Easy, What is WebSphere That Doesn't Sell Too Much Anymore, Pickering of Springfield, which is all about the Simpsons. They're all available over on Amazon. Oh, then you'll also notice Darcy DeClute's Scrum Master Certification Guide at Scrumptuous on Twitter. I helped edit that book after it was written, so kind of proud of it. So if you want to get Scrum Master certified, or you know someone who's agile working with Scrum and they'd like to advance their career, I highly recommend that book. A number of people are reading that book and scoring 100% on the exam, so please check it out. And then finally, if you're watching this on YouTube, why don't you subscribe on YouTube?